Scripture comes to us from Psalm 29, verses 1 through 11. Ascribe to the Lord, O heavenly beings, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory of his name. Worship the Lord in holy splendor. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The glory of God thunders. The Lord over mighty waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon. He makes Lebanon skip like a calf and Sarion like a young wild ox. The voice of the Lord flashes forth flames of fire. The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord causes the oaks to whirl and strips the forest bare, and in his temple, all say glory. The Lord sits enthroned over the flood. The Lord sits enthroned as king forever. May the Lord give strength to his people. May the Lord bless his people with peace. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Holy and eternal God, Lord, we come to you on this morning. Lord, grateful for all that you have done for us. Yes. God, grateful that we are made in your image. Lord, grateful that we are a part of creation. All that's in it, Lord God, your hand has touched. We are grateful, Lord God, for those days where the sun burns brightly. We're grateful, Lord God, for those days when you shower the earth with rain. Lord, we look upon it all with hearts of thanksgiving. Grateful, Lord God, that we are able to see and touch and be a part of it all. Lord, your works are many and wonderful. And God, we just ask that you continue to do the transformative work that needs to be done in all our hearts. Lord, this is our humble prayer, and we pray it in the name of your Son, Jesus the Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Friends, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice. Let us rejoice. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us lift our voices singing one of the great hymns of the church, What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
Whoa.
my siblings in Christ, God's love has been poured into our hearts through the gift of the Holy Spirit. The proof of God's amazing love is this: while we were sinners, Christ died for us. Because we have faith in him, we dare to approach God in confidence. Let us confess our sin before Almighty God. Gracious God, our sins are too heavy to carry, too real to hide, and too deep to undo. Forgive what our lips tremble to name, what our hearts can no longer bear, and what has become for us a consuming fire of judgment. Set us free from a past that we cannot change. Open to us a future in which we can be changed, and grant us grace to grow more and more in your likeness and image through Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone. A new life has begun. Believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Welcome once again to our virtual worship experience. We are grateful that you continue to tune in week after week. We are grateful that you continue to support the great work of this ministry through your tithes and offerings. And we just like to extend an invitation to those who are seeking to be in relationship with Christ. You are welcome to worship with us, not only virtually, but we extend an invitation to you as we prepare to make our move back into the sanctuary this summer. Let us pray. Awesome God, gracious God, God of love, God of mercy, Lord, oh, all that you have done for us. We are so grateful. We are so thankful. We praise your holy name because when we look back over our lives, we can see where you carried us. And so, God, we are grateful that you continue to keep your promise to your children. We are grateful that you continue to carry us even in the midst of a pandemic. God, we are grateful because you have given us another opportunity to do your good and perfect will. Lord, in this hour, as we prepare to worship you in spirit and in truth, we ask that you open our hearts and our eyes and our ears to hear a word from on high. God, I ask that you decrease me and increase your Holy Spirit in, through, and around me. As I prepare, O Lord, to proclaim your word. Lord, we pray for those who are sick and homebound, asking that you strengthen them, God. Keep them. Give them comfort. We pray for their caregivers who give care day in and day out. Remind them, Lord God, that they are not alone, that you are with them. Remind them, Lord God, that they are in our prayers always. Lord, whatever their needs are, meet them. Lord, we pray for those who are hungry and homeless, asking that you do what you do so well. Lord, feed them physically, feed them spiritually, restore them, Lord God. Restore in them, Lord God, what is lost. Help them, Lord God, to be whole and to continue to make their way in this world. We pray, Lord God, for those who serve in any capacity, public servants, Lord God, those who work in the hospitals, in the nursing homes, the funeral homes, in churches, in schools, Lord God, all of those things, God, that we, those places and jobs and functions that we need, Lord God, in order to have some normalcy in our day-to-day lives. Lord, we pray for this world and all its brokenness, God, asking that you heal the land. Do what only you can do, Lord. Get our attention. Help us to focus, Lord God, to correct those things that have been long broken. Help us, Lord God, to love one another, to love our neighbors as ourselves. Help us, Lord God, to be better human beings. Help us to be better followers of Jesus Christ. Lord, we lift up those who mourn, not only in this moment, but who have been mourning since the pandemic hit. God, we ask that you be their comfort, be their strength when they can't figure it out, they can't make sense of it all. Lord, help us to look back over the past 14, 15 months and to see all that you have done in the world. All of the things, God, that have been exposed, those things that are broken, Lord God, that no longer serve our greater good. God, continue to make us see what needs to be done. Lord, we pray for those who hold elected offices, asking that you would continue to be with them and guide them. God, allow the Holy Spirit to reside in the halls of Congress and, Lord, anywhere where laws are being made, let them be just laws, Lord God. Let them be equitable laws. Let them be laws, Lord God, that the people can bear. Lord, we pray for those who are still stuck at the border, Lord God, detained, not knowing which way to go. God, help us to do whatever we can to lessen their burden. They desire freedom, Lord God, and we know that there is freedom in you. And so, Lord, as long as they hold on, Lord God, and have faith in you and what you can do and what you have done, we pray, Lord God, that their load will be lessened. Lord, we thank you. You have brought us through so much. You continue to teach us and to give us wisdom. And so we pray that all that you impart to us, that we will be responsible enough to share, Lord God, with others, to tell the good news of the gospel without a care, without shame and without guilt. We will proclaim to the world, Lord God, all that you have done for us and your love for us all. To anyone willing to hear that word, Lord, bless us and keep us. Bless this ministry, Lord God. Bless the members that continue to support it, Lord God. Be with us all as we prepare, Lord God, to come back together in some form, Lord God, knowing that when we come back together, it's going to be a great time. To come together, God, to praise you and to share the stories of how we got over, how you brought us through. Not only during this pandemic, but in days past. Lord, this is our humble prayer, and we pray it in the name of your Son, Jesus the Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. We will now have a song from our choir.
Father, help your children and don't let them fall by the side of the road. But teach them to love one another, that heaven might find a place in their heart. But Jesus, He won't let you down. And I know He is mine forever. Oh, in my heart, you got to walk on, walk on through temptation, but His is love, and His wisdom will be our helping hand. But I know the truth, and His words will be our salvation. So lift up our hearts to be thankful and glad. But Jesus is love. He won't let you down. And I know Jesus is love. Oh, yes, He is. He won't let you down. And I know He's mine. He's mine, He's mine, He's mine, all mine forever. Yeah.
fire. Jesus is love. Jesus is our mainstay. Jesus is our Savior, our joy. Jesus is love, the partner of our sin. This morning's sermonic text comes from 2 Kings chapter 11, verses 1 through 3. Now when Athaliah, Ahaziah's mother, saw that her son was dead, she set about to destroy all the royal family. But Jehosheba, King Joram's daughter, Ahaziah's sister, took Joash, son of Ahaziah, and stole him away from among the king's children who were about to be killed. She put him and his nurse in a bedroom. Thus she hid him from Athaliah so that he was not killed. He remained with her 6 years, hidden in the house of the Lord with Athaliah, while Athaliah reigned over the land. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Pray with me, if you will. Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I'd like for you to think with me this morning from the sermon title, A Fearless Woman. A Fearless Woman. During the era of slavery, the Underground Railroad was a network of routes and places and people that helped enslaved people in the American South escape to the North. The name Underground Railroad was used metaphorically, not literally. It was not an actual railroad, but it served the same purpose. It transported people long distances. It also did not run underground, but through homes and barns and churches and businesses. The people who worked for the Underground Railroad had a passion for justice and drive to end the practice of slavery. A drive so strong that they risked their lives and jeopardized their own freedom to help enslaved people escape from bondage and keep them safe along the route. According to some estimates, between 1810 and 1850, the Underground Railroad helped to guide 100,000 enslaved people to freedom. As the network grew, the railroad metaphor stuck. Conductors guided runaway enslaved people from place to place along the routes. The places that sheltered the runaways were referred to as stations, and the people who hid the enslaved people were called station masters. The fugitives traveling along the routes were called passengers, and those who had arrived at the safe houses were called cargo. In this morning's text, we find Jehosheba in a crisis that requires quick thinking, courage, and wisdom. We have a story of two women, one grief-stricken and angry and seeking revenge over the death of her son. The other woman is courageous and fearless, and in that moment, she is required to make a decision and to take a stand. Jehosheba is the daughter of King Joram, where there were two King Jorams. One was the king of Judah and the other was the king of Israel. She was the daughter of the king of Israel. Her father, King Joram, was the ninth king of Israel. He was the son of Jehoshaphat. Jehosheba was a princess and she was married to the high priest Jehoiada. This is the only time in the Bible that we see this princess married to a high priest. Jehosheba was a a half sister to King Uzziah. King Uzziah's mother was Athalah, and Athalah was the daughter of the evil king and queen duel, King Ahab and Queen Jezebel. Jehosheba was a half-sister to King Ahaziah, but Athalah was not her mother. And so this morning we see a story of two women who have a desire to do something, one for evil, the other for good. And so the question becomes this morning, why do we allow fear to hold us back from doing the right thing? Why do we allow evil to get in the way of doing the right thing? My friends, first and foremost, Jehosheba had faith. She had faith. She knew that something needed to be done. If she did not protect her nephew, surely he would be killed. My friends, like Jehosheba, we must take a stand for something or we will fall for anything. Jehosheba found herself in a position that other women in the Bible had faced to save the lives of those in peril in order to preserve future generations. Like Queen Esther and Moses' sister Miriam and all the others, she found herself in a position to do something. She had the courage and the faith to trust God in the process. And my friends, we are called to have the same faith. And though we may not end up in the same situation every day, we are called to do something, to make a difference in the world, to set something wrong right. And my friends, when we walk with God, when we have faith in God, we can do this knowing that God has our back. If God is for us, who can be against us? Who can be against us? And so here is this princess, Jehosheba, going up against the queen, who just happens to be the daughter of Jezebel. And if you know anything about Jezebel, you know she had a controlling spirit. You know that she was maniacal. You know that she did not play. And so this is what Jehosheba was going up against, but she did not let it stop her. And so with her faith in God, her actions were also rooted in fearlessness. My friends, sometimes we must make tough decisions even when we are scared to death and uncertain of the outcome. Friends, sometimes even as our lips tremble and our voices crack, we must do what needs to be done and we must say what needs to be said because somebody, somewhere is depending on us to do so. When you think back to the story of the Underground Railroad. Had they not been a Harriet Tubman who was, maybe she was afraid in the beginning, but she had her faith in God. And as a result, she led many enslaved African Americans to freedom. She did something, stood on her faith, felt the fear, and did it anyway. Had it not been for Ida B. Wells and her fearlessness, what would we know about the atrocities of lynching? Ida B. Wells used her voice to speak truth to power about the atrocities of lynching in the black community. She was a fearless woman, just like Harriet Tubman was a fearless woman, just like Jehosheba was a fearless woman. What if Susan B. Anthony did not raise her voice to advocate for a woman's right to vote? What if Sojourner Truth didn't declare, "Ain't I a woman?" Making the case that a woman's race, creed, or class should not deny her basic human rights. Those women had power to change the world. And what about Anne Frank, young Anne Frank? Did she not have the courage to record all of the evil that she was in the midst of during Nazi Germany and the war? She was courageous. If she did not record her story, look at what we would have lost. During the Ohio Women's Rights Convention of 1851, Sojourner Truth, in her landmark speech, "Ain't I a Woman," said to the crowd, "If the first woman God ever made was strong enough to turn the world upside down all alone, these women together ought to be able to turn it back and get it right side up again." These women were fearless. And so, my friends, I know I want this story is for everybody. But on this fifth Sunday, where we traditionally celebrate Women's Sunday, I want to remind you that we have power. I want to remind you that God is calling us to do something. The question is, what is God calling you to do? What does God need you to stand up to? Sometimes we don't want to answer the call because we feel like we have to sacrifice too much. But I stand here to tell you today that you can't sacrifice more than what Jesus did. And so therefore, we are not exempt from doing what God has purposed us to do. We are called out to be fearless. Scripture tells us that God does not give us the spirit of fear. And so sometimes those things that cause us to be afraid, those external things, people around us with negativity, those who don't believe you can do anything, sometimes you have to let people go. You've got to cut them off. Because if you don't, they will surely keep you stuck. Sometimes we've got to leave relationships that don't push us to grow, not only individually, but to grow together. Not only together, but to grow in God. Some things we have to cut off. What's getting in your way of being a fearless woman? What is stopping you? Sometimes it's a job that's not really for you. But you're too afraid to step out and do what it is God has purposed you for. My friends, a fearless woman will calculate all the risk. And even when she cannot see the full picture, she will march forward because she knows that the Lord our God is with her. My friends, Jehosheba understood what was happening. She understood what was happening. And so not only did she have faith, not only was she fearless, but she also knew that God was her protector, just as God is our protector. Listen, Athaliah decided to kill all of Ahaziah's sons because of God's promise that the Messiah would come from David's descendants. And so she was determined to shut everything down. She had lost her son. Her son had been killed. So she was determined that if the Messiah wasn't coming through her line, nobody was going to be happy. She was determined to interrupt the royal bloodline, that Davidic line, Jesus' bloodline, my friends. This is what she was trying to interrupt. Jesus' genealogy. And my friends, I need you to know and understand that God is always God. God is always present, and God's plan will always be fulfilled. This story serves to remind us that no one's agenda can ever be bigger than God's agenda. God's plans cannot be thwarted, delayed maybe, but never thwarted. And watch this. All those years of hiding her nephew, the queen never once thought to look in the church. The child had been hidden in the church all those years. And so, friends, sometimes the places we need to go to find out what we need to know, we don't go because we don't think we need it. And so that's where we've come to. That's the point we've come to now, not only in this passage, but also in many of our lives. We don't feel we have a need for the church anymore. We have become comfortable in our living and our thinking. Life is not as hard as it used to be. I can do all right if I don't go to church. And this is not to condemn anyone who does not go. What I'm saying is sometimes what you need is in the place you refuse to enter. And so this is what the queen found herself with. She never darkened the door of the church. Her plan was never carried out. My friends, it takes faith, fearlessness, and trust in God to know that God is our protector. When we are on the side of right, God will always stand with us. Women, be fearless. Men, be fearless. Children, be fearless. Women, be courageous. Women, be confident in who you are and whose you are. Women, lead. Women, lead with love. Women, teach. Women, rescue. Women, live. Strive to be a fearless woman and see what God can do through you. In the name of the one who was and who is to come. Amen. Friends, I charge you this week to be fearless, to take on something that you probably would never give a thought about taking on. But even if it frightens you, as long as God is in it, I promise you, God will see you through. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord be kind and gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace now and forevermore. Amen.
Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. God has spoken, so let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. God has spoken, so let the church say amen. One more time. Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. Oh, let him say
amen.
Let him say
amen.
Let him say
amen.
Let him say
amen.
God has spoken, so let the church say
amen.
Church.